And now I'm particularly happy and proud about our next speaker, who is Sepp Hochreiter. He's the head of Institute of Bioinformatics at the Johannes Kepler University in Linz. But he's world renowned for inventing the long short-term memory we've heard about a little bit already in the last talk. And this was 1992 when Sepp invented the so-called LSTM, which today are very important in many, many applications of AI, especially speech recognition, translation, and so on. So these so-called LSTMs autonomously learn to memorize, but also to selectively forget information over time. That's their specialty. And Sepp is a very important reason why we're all here tonight. So we thank him specially for coming. We were very, very early on approaching him, and his condition for coming was, yeah, good beer. sorry for sharing that. I hope you all had good beer now. So let's get to our new next speaker. I want to mention also we heard the great news that we're going to keep Sepp for a while in Austria because he's leading and creating the LIT AI lab, as far as I've heard. Give a big applause to Sepp Hochreiter, our next speaker.
Thank you for the introduction. Thank you for having me. It's true, I'm staying here. I'm not going to Mountain View or other sites. And Vienna is very nice. But check out Linz and Salzgitter gut. I will touch on this later also. Everybody is talking about it. Artificial intelligence is coming. And indeed, it will come. It will invade everything. Your private life, your working life. You will encounter it in holidays, on your desk. It will come, and it will come heavily. Be prepared. We heard from Google. Google is also betting on it. But it's not only Google. There's the self-driving cars. There's the fashion. There's many, many things. AI will be there, but you will not see it always. Should we be anxious? That's not what I have in mind with AI. That's Hollywood. That's not we will see in the future. That is stuff we see in the movies, not in our daily life. We will see more this kind of things, machines becoming more intelligent, machines helping us more, machines understanding us, machines understanding the world. What is AI? Perhaps a couple of statements I took from Forbes. AI is a black box. That's a bad thing. We don't understand everything what these guys are learning. But we also don't know everything what humans are learning. We still trust them. AI is difficult, yes. It's not as easy, you take it and you make it. We wanted Rosie, it's a household robot, but we got Roomba, this little thing which is driving around. Yes, driving will become a hobby. You will, if you drive, you can read a book, look, watch movies. Also, culture and context is important with AIs. So future AIs will have to understand humanity, will have to understand people, have to know what is it to be human. Do they take our jobs? Yes, they will take some of the jobs. the repetitive jobs, the boring jobs, but many, many more jobs will be created. AIs will not kill us, as the movies tell us. AIs will not use us as batteries, like in the Matrix, because that would not be very intelligent, because for batteries, there are better techniques available. AI seems like a little bit magic, yes, but still, with this magic, it's limited. It has its borders. We cannot do everything. What should AI be? It should help us. It should increase our own human intelligence. It's augmented intelligence. It's an enrichment of skills we already have. And it will change how we will perceive computers, how we will interact with computers, how we use our mobile devices. It's already here. Facebook. We have a guy from Facebook. There's another guy from Facebook. He's not so famous than you because he's not so good in AI, but he was at the NIPS conference. But he's still good known. Facebook are good in text. You showed us, Thomas, and they're really good. Imagine all human knowledge is written down as text. If AIs would have access to text, understand text, they would have access to all human knowledge. But also Google, there was a guy from Google, I guess. I will repeat a couple of things from Google. Google is also an AI. Google is an AI company. They also bet on it. Here's something like, we know, okay, Google. You have cell phones. Who has cell phones? Who is using OK Google? Everybody. Who is not using OK Google? Ah, yeah, there are two. We got slides. You already presented the slides. I will go over it. Google. He's from Google. He has until 2016. I only come up with 2015. I'm a year behind. But they have a lot of projects internally on AI, on deep learning. Amazon, do we have Amazon here? Then also Amazon is going into AI. You know this, Alexa, you have this box at home. Everything is connected, you can talk to them. Also Google has something on the market, I think it's Google Home. But other companies will follow. You have your home device, your butler helping at home. Also, this company is on the market. You hardly remember it, but perhaps of this Apple, you remember this company. They are not so forcing, but they are trying to keep up. They lost a little bit. And also, they have stuff like this on the market. Yes, it's the dawn of AI. AI will come. AI will change our future. One number, or a couple of numbers I want to bring to your attention is, now we are about here, we have perhaps the computational power of an insect brain, perhaps of a mouse brain. In a few years, let's say 2024, we have the computational power on our cell phones of a human brain. Waiting a couple of years, about 2050, we have the computational power in our computers of all human brains existing now in this world. Only looking at these numbers of computational power, it's not intelligent right now, but there's something approaching us, something is coming. There are countries preparing for it. This is Germany, that's a minister from Germany. There was Industry 4.0. But now it's changing to learning systems, digitalizing. And I put in here a small graphics. Machine learning, the traditional methods, get saturated with the amount of data, but not deep learning. Deep learning is the driver of AI right now. Deep learning is data hungry. We are producing more and more data. We saw in the last talk, there are models out. If you have more data, you get better models. We're producing more data, and this scales. And that's cool. What is deep learning? Deep learning, intelligence from big data. Big data, we are happy about big data. It's not a curse, it's a blessing for us. We need this data to build intelligence, to make neural networks learn. Perhaps to put AI, machine learning, and deep learning in context, here, I do it here, that's AI. It's a big field, including robotics, natural language processing, all this stuff. Here's machine learning. It's a subfield. It's about learning. And learning is something different than some guys learned in school. Here you learn programming. You think about a problem, and then you write a program. With learning, it's different. You feed the system with data, and the system comes up with a solution. Even with a solution, you never thought about it. You only thought about how it should learn. But you never thought about it, what it should learn, and what are the details. The details are hidden in the data. These machine learning tools are data hungry, extract structures from data, and there produce their knowledge, rules, intelligence. And the last field is deep learning, and deep learning is the field why AI is booming right now. Look at the companies, look what's going on Facebook, Google, and so on. It's this field, it's neural networks, these old guys who now became very, very powerful using the data. So many AI applications. I put some of the slide, but I don't go through them. Deep learning is already implemented in self-driving cars, Apple, Google, Amazon, Netflix, you know, the companies, whether it's recommendation systems, which it's personal assistance. So personal assistance will become much more impressive. So personal assistance will become personal friends, giving you advice. Deep learning is already in the companies. 40% use machine learning to improve the performance on the market. 38% think that the improvement is really driven by machine learning, and 76% want to use machine learning in the future. These are some numbers. A lot of money is flowing into AI. I'll skip it. We know this. You remember it. I also have to touch on this a little bit. It was reinforcement learning. It was from the deep mind guys. And actually, they controlled the cooling systems, they controlled the fans of the computers, switching them on and off, depending on how much energy is consumed. And that's really helped the guys from Google. And DeepMind was bought by 500 million euros, perhaps only using this. It paid off. We also saw this. I have similar examples, but it's good I can skip over them. Who of you are still going to human doctors? Who is going to AIs? Oh, well, very few. This will change. Don't trust human doctors for diagnostics because machines are better. Don't trust human drivers. Machines are better. I'm telling for diagnostics. Still trust your doctor if it's about therapy. He knows it. But only looking at the skin, these machines can look at millions of images of the skin cancer across the world, from China, from India. And if some guys did a tell, it's a nice Salzkammergut. If you're sitting in a nice Salzkammergut, there's one doctor, he had perhaps 1,000 patients, most of them healthy. But this machine has millions and millions and millions examples. It has also the rare examples. And these machines are better in diagnostics. Still, your doctor will tell you what you should do. But for diagnostics, go to the machines. Also, this is an example you already mentioned. I can tell you a story about this. There were some guys in the AI community doing Go a long time. Everybody was smiling at them. And the exact same guys, years afterwards, build up the system, really beating one of the best Go players. And nobody was expecting this. Everybody thought, we are not there. AI is not there to beat a good Go player. Wrong. We are there. That was a big surprise for many guys because the field is evolving very, very rapidly. Don't be overrun. Where's deep learning? Where's it very good? In vision. Here, examples. You give some machine some zebras and say, the machine, can you make horses out of it? It can. Or you give a horse and make zebras. Or at nice images, you say, yeah, it's a summer, but can you make winter? Yes, the machines can now, or from winter to summer. So I can do all this stuff. Now I will try. I'm not sure. Normally, it does not work. If it would work, it would be the first time. Yeah, it's the first time.
Cup, pot, cup, coffee cup.
That's what deep learning can do right now.
Pepsi, cherry.
That's
Pepsi, Cola,
a cell phone
Coca-Cola.
Pointing at different.
Trash can.
You are looking at a new Apple earbuds.
Hey, wow. That is all right. That sounds like magic. I mean, I don't know how they can. Wow, that's so impressive. I don't even know what to say. I'm just kind of shocked.
There's another movie. It's without sound. You see the guy on the right. And now it's style transfer. There are some pictures on the left. And the pictures on the left are transferred to this guy speaking. You don't hear what he's speaking. You're very lucky. And it's impressive. It's going online, how this style is overlaid onto this speaker. Now, something else. Similar theme. You probably know this guy, that's the original one, and that's not a famous politician. You're using this video and this you see perhaps on the screen. And if you see this on And there are elections. You never know what's going on the TV if you would see this. Perhaps some of the deep learning students is sitting behind it and producing stuff like this. Here, speech, text, language. I think that's a very, very important field. Facebook is going this direction, but also other companies. Text is the source of knowledge, and we should tap on it. We should use it. We should let AIs having access to it so that they can understand the world, because our knowledge of the world is in text. If some of you went to school, I guess some did, you have all the school books, all the knowledge is in books. What we can use is, you already mentioned it, the long short-term memory, perhaps a short history. I did it in 1991 in my diploma thesis, but not even my supervisor was aware of it, what I did there, because it was the second part, he only read the first part. Later, he asked me, hey, Sepp, you wrote something in your thesis. Can we publish it? I said, I don't know. And there was also this vanishing gradient. Also the LSTM architecture there. Then we tried to publish it, but it was rejected. First, your supervisor does not read it, and then if you want to publish it, it gets rejected. If there are some young students, be happy if your paper gets rejected. It's a sign of being very innovative. You have to wait 25 years and then check out your paper again. It took a while until, Thomas already told it, guys became aware of the power of RNNs, of recurrent neural networks. And they worked. Joshua Bengio, one of the big guys also in this deep learning company, hey, Sepp, RNNs are back in the game. I went to a conference, it was one of the flagship conferences, there was one guy, he's called Geoff Hinton, and as I was a little Sepp, I had a poster there, once with LSTM, and if Geoff went by, my heart was going, Pepsi is looking at me. He never looked at me, of course. And then I went to the same conference, and Geoff was running at me, hey, Sepp, everybody's using your LSTM. Times are changing. Don't be frustrated if you don't make, in your first week, €1 million, if your papers get rejected. Wait a long, long time. And now it's used in Google's Android, Google's Voice, Apple iOS, QuickTime, Google's Translate, Amazon, Alexa. Also Facebook is using it, we heard about it. And also Amazon really heavily is using it. If they have some, for translation, if they, I know Ralf Herbrich is boss of the Amazon Research, if a French guy puts some products on the, how should I say, web page, and he has a French description, if you translate it into English, the guys from London will buy it. If you translate it in German, the guys from Berlin will buy it. If you translate the product description, helps a lot in increasing, growing their sales. There's a lot in there, also translation of the websites will give access to the people. There are many people that speak German, that speak Spanish, but cannot speak English. But to make the web accessible for all these people will come soon with this automatic translation. Also, the LSTM is viewed of one of the, at least by some guys, of the key moments of deep learning. This is a slice I slept in. I didn't use it. I put in the slides a couple of minutes ago because Thomas told you. I think the strength of LSTM is it does uniform credit assignment. All guys are talking about memory bullshit. The good thing is, Uniform Credit Assignment is via its architecture, it's treating each word in a sentence on the same level. No matter whether the word is at the end or at the beginning, you can change the sentences. LSTM starts saying this word is equally as important for me as this word and this word. And it's going over it and accumulating. And that's the big idea. If you have a sentence, standard recurrent neural networks always focused on the last word or the last three words. With this technique, you can focus on every word in the sentence. And every word could be of interest. And now, LSTM are able even to produce thoughts, ideas. Like you have the word see, cocktail, surfboard. And now you see in your mind, you're lying on the strand, on a beach, drinking cocktail holidays. But I could also have said, I don't know, beach, holidays, swimming, sun, sun cream, and you have the same image in your brain, and this image can be stored by one of these LSTM memory cells. A situation, a thought, an idea, and that's the strength of this new modern techniques. There are other things. Do you have the time? You don't have the time. I go ahead. We have projects with Zalando. Kelvin will give a talk on it about text and image. We have a lot of projects at JKU. So JKU is the new Google. Did I tell this to you? We have a big AI lab, and Google is very frightened. We have projects with pharma companies. Also, Intel is an IT. 10 minutes is very good. Then I should slip more slides in. With pharma companies, where we use deep learning. Also, in pharma, deep learning makes a difference, has a huge impact. We now can predict side effects very early. Side effects which would appear at the late phase of clinical studies. Some pharma companies changed their research department, and some, even something like Bayer. Bayer want to build its own AI, I heard. It has a huge impact on pharma because all these predictions of biological effects of some molecules, the computer can do better. And so I have a neural network where the network learned more about chemistry, about toxicity, than was knowledge in pharma companies. It detected toxic site change where all the guys, all the chemists in the pharma company we are not aware of. I go over this. We have also collaboration with automotive. They're interested in self-driving cars. We're working especially with Audi. Yes, we have also in Linz. Linz is new Mountain View, and JKU is the new Google. Come to Linz. We have the Audi.jku Deep Learning Center. We're looking for guys with Audi and with the VW concern. We're trying to bring the AI into the self-driving cars to make self-driving cars. We need guys, help us. All these companies are looking for good guys. Yes, I can also show you, it's working here. This is the stuff we are doing. It's called semantic segmentation. You have a camera in your car, and now you want to figure out what's car, what's human, because the Audi said they want not overall humans. What's some interesting stuff. Most importantly is here, what's street and what's not street. That is a big issue where we use now LSTMs, we use attention mechanisms, because now the cars should focus on the important stuff and not on the unimportant stuff. Important stuff is a pedestrian is going towards the street. Please have a look at this guy, or if you want to pass by a car, keep focus on this car and don't do segmentation of the trash can at the side or a tree. Attention, this LSTM we bring into this project. I want to show you what the machines can do. We give this to machines, I mean, machine have to tell what it's seeing. What do we see? Spaceball? Let's ask the machine. The machine is saying, a baseball player is throwing a ball in front of the field. Yes, cool. Here's the ball. What do we see? Let's ask the machine. People are playing frisbee on grass. Grass, frisbee, it's okay. It wouldn't be possible a couple of years ago. Now you can ask the machine what it's seeing on the image. What's here? Dog, probably. A dog is walking on a sandy beach. Yeah, some stones, but it's okay. What's this? We don't know. I cannot see it, but the machine is telling me a man riding on a bike through the mud. I see mud, yeah. So that's okay. Is somebody practicing this sport? I have no idea what it is. And therefore we ask the machine. There are two men who appear to be practicing martial arts. No, that's okay. But I was not aware that they're practicing, but if I look at it, they're far away. Probably they're practicing. No, the machine is good. We have a collaboration with Zalando. Therefore, I can use a Zalando image. What does the machine see? A pretty young girl holding a wine bottle in her hand. You're laughing. No, I have to excuse the machine, because in the training data, if something red was in the hand, it was mostly wine bottles. So shoes were on the feet in most cases, not in the hand. But that was not the interesting thing. The more interesting stuff is, how does the machine know it's a pretty young girl? And we made an investigation and saw that the machine discovered a physical law. And the physical law was, all girls are pretty and young. Thank you. That's Upper Austria. We established a lit AI lab. We are looking for smart guys. Come to Linz. Check who is the new Google. Linz is the new Mountain View. You can work near this site. So Chinese guys have to steal it. And you can work near this site. You can work near this site.
Thank you very much, Seb. Thank you very much. That was a real nice closing statement. I guess you're hiring girls too?
We're hiring even AIs. Yes, we're hiring girls. We have a lot of girls actually in my group, because we are also, my group is in bioinformatics. So are going in direction life science. Also one of a very smart girl, she studied medicine and now is fascinated about AI. Yes, of course.
Okay, let's go to the questions. Where do we have the Slido? Yeah. So, okay, very popular question was, Putin says the nation that leads in AI will be the ruler of the world. What's your opinion on this?
Oh, so it's very political. I would say I downtone it a little bit. AI will be important for every country to build up the infrastructure, to help the people, even for the third country, not developed countries, to produce food. Even Bayer Crop Science now has drones flying and looking where it's dry. You can produce more food in the poor countries, even there it's important. Of course it will be important everywhere. It's not too wrong, but there is more than AI, and whether ruling the world is a good goal, I would say it's questionable.
Okay, let's get back a little bit in history, and here we have the question, how did you come up with the idea of LSTMs, and what was the problem you tried to solve?
Do you want to know everything, or? that was very easy. Jürgen at this time told me it was a chunker system, how to solve a problem, and for me it was important first to understand the problem, to seeing what's going on. And I really sat down in the computer, did step by step, followed the backprop. And then I saw it's getting smaller and smaller, the numbers. And I thought about it. I want to do induction proofs to prove something that it doesn't get smaller. And then I looked really in the bits and the bytes of the neural network to understand why is it not working. I want to understand it. And then I came up with a simple architecture, which is one memory cell with one connection to itself, which is a recurrent connection, and then I figured out the only function which is solving this is the identity function. Only the identity function, if I make a derivative, if I make the derivative of x with respect to x, one remains. And that was the solution, finally. I looked very deep in the details.
Deep learning.
Yeah. This.
There is another question actually about small data sets. So the question I would attach to that one is like, what data did you have at that time in 91? What data did you use? How big or small was it? And what problem you were about to solve?
We were so poor that we even produced our own data. We come up with some task. It's in the old papers like Rapper Grammar. I produced all the data online. Also the stuff, what's now going on, it was not there. We don't have this big data sets. We produced some data online. We come up with problems and learned it. Now it's everything is different, like also the architectures which are there, like the output gate. The output gate in the LSTM is a fake. It was only a joke. It was only to get the paper published. And indeed, I would never use it because it's bullshit.
Okay, good to hear 25 years later. Okay, let's keep on the data side. Here was the question, if we can't trust human doctors, how can we trust the ground truth annotations they provide for the machine learning?
Uh-huh. That's a different question for me, but I have a couple of answers. First of all, you can average over your experts. If you have not one person, if you have one person, the machine will learn exactly the errors of this one person. But if you have more persons, the machine can average. But why rely on humans? You also can have direct data where you see, because of later diagnosis, what really happened. Was it cancer? Was it not cancer? There you have the ground truth. Otherwise, you're as good as the average of it. And now something interesting comes. I convinced the pharma companies, we now have machines in place which are better than the experiments they predict. The machines are better than the experiments they were learned on. By this, the machines predict the average value, the average outcome. And if you do an experiment in the lab, you have noise attached to the result. The average outcome is more precise than a single experiment because the machine learns averaging over many examples. Therefore, we say, if you go to the lab, you get worse results than with our machines. And some pharma companies already bought it.
Impressive. one more question here is, your group is very active working on topics related to GANs, the general adversarial networks. What's the outlook of using GANs for biological data?
For biological data? Oh, that's a hard one.
Specialized question.
I don't have any things. What we are now doing, should I reveal everything? I'm not sure about this. What we are now doing is constructing new drugs, new medication with GANs by first saying there's a machine producing artificial new molecules. And the machine would say, is it human-made, a human-made drug, or is it a machine-made drug? If there's no difference, you can use the machines to have a lot of proposals of new drugs. And there are so many proposals, but this doesn't matter because there are other machines using all these proposals and making the experiments. And there are other machines checking the experiments. Therefore, we will use GANs to have a medication company. We only push one button, at the other side, a medication will come out. Because everything can be done by machines. Even the design of new drugs with GANs.
Nice, nice. Do we have a question from the audience that's not online? There. Alex, please.
I've recently noticed your name on the paper on self-normalizing linear units and stuff. And I was just curious that if the proof was generated by LSTM or not.
Did you read the appendix? The Audi guys only printed it out and put it on the wall. We worked really hard, but we have our AIs are not there, but we used a tool, it's called Mathematica. And many of the formulas we copy and pasted from Mathematica, but it took a long time to do all the stuff. And because also some guys get frustrated, like Günther was very frustrated, shouldn't we not throw it out? Now we should prove it. If we have something proven, the guys will use it because it's proven that it's working. And we didn't know that's so hard to prove all these little small details. You come from one problem to another problem to another problem to another problem. But we have this Mathematica. Therefore, we didn't do everything behind. In the future, perhaps we should use LSTM. You're right.
Is there another question here? Yeah. Over there, Alex at the corner. Yeah.
Do you think that we will be able to achieve artificial general intelligence with the model architectures that we have right now? So are the data and the computational capacities the limiting factor, or do we really need a revolution in terms of the model architectures we have in order to achieve generalization?
Thank you for the question. It helps me a lot. Now I can tell you it's one of our goals to build really a general AI. General AI would be something which understands the world. The idea we have is you build an AI, it has a world knowledge. We're doing it right now, but we call this AI students at the moment, and we send it to the companies and say, specializing what we do with education with students, I want to do with AIs, build a general AI. It has vision capabilities. It has acoustic capabilities. It can hear, it can see, it can touch, it can move. And then it goes out to company and specializes it, becomes a driver, becomes a household robot. We're going there. One of our problems is that's a self-normalizing network we are investigating. There are other things going on in reinforcement learning. We have something very cool in petto, which is mind-blowing. But the big problem is there are many networks talking to each other. To building a big AI system, we're doing it with neural networks, but there's more. There will be neuroscience, there will be reasoning, there will be much more than only deep learning. We're doing it with deep learning, building very large AI systems which have a knowledge of the world, but all these components to bring together is hard. Therefore, self-normalizing networks, therefore, two time-scaled learning systems where one system is learning faster than the other. We're going in this direction to build very, very large systems. But it's deep learning is not enough.
Very quick final question. Will Austria become leading in AI thanks to your AI lab?
Austria is already leading. In Europe, if we exclude
good.
DeepMind. And if we focus on something like recurrent neural networks, deep learning, we are well established. If we publish stuff, all the guys asking us, I'm a good fella, if we publish, sends always emails, this guy who invented the guns. He will say, hey Sepp, what's about this? I didn't think, and blah, can you give me a code? And we are there, but we will increase and we will really establish this. JKU is the new Google, and Linz is the new Mountain View. Come to Linz, there's Hallstatt, there's the Salzkammergut, Vienna is good, but look at Oppo Austria, we looking for smart guys. Come, and we will be world leading, except Google, Facebook, Zalando.